So, first of all, thanks Chairperson and thanks Glenmark for giving me this opportunity to talk about the tunnel captain. I have a conflict of interest as this talk is sponsored and supported by Glenmark. I'll be talking in next 15 to 20 minutes the glycemic variability, the clinical relevance and the new evidence with DPP-4. This is a gliptin symposia where we had discussed different gliptins and we were talking the different evidence of different gliptins, and we are using, and one of the most common used gliptin in our country is tanelagliptin. So I would like to have a newer data which we have published, and I was the principal investigator for this glycemic variability along with tanelagliptin. The glycemic assessment in diabetes is a parameter which we were using HbA1c since long. It was glucose first we used to do, and then we started instead of doing multiple times glucose, we were getting HbA1c, which is an average of 3 months. Then we are moving now beyond A1c. And what is moving beyond A1c mean? Now we are no more only talking about the A1c. We also want in between what is happening. So in between any interday or intraday glycemic excursion, because A1C does not provide any information on frequency, duration or magnitude of short-term fluctuation of glycemia. HbA1C cannot assess hypoglycemia and glycemic variability. It gets easily affected by conditions like renal failure, hemoglobinopathies, chronic liver disease, or even for iron deficiency anemia also. So we are now moving beyond A1C. Like the way before 20 years, we changed our clinical practice from doing multiple times glucose monitoring to the average glucose, which is A1C. So the paradigm shift in diabetes management from glycemic triad to glycemic pentad. So this move from beyond A1C, because before that it was fasting plasma glucose, post-meal glucose level or A1C, that is what typical of glycemic triad, which we want for our diabetic patients to have a control. We moved from glycemic triad to glycemic pentad, which is other than A1C, fasting and postprandial glucose level. We also want to look for the glycemic variability and hypoglycemia too. What is exactly glycemic variability? It is a consistent predictor of hypoglycemia. It is a hypoglycemia which is associated with significant morbidity and increased mortality. It is a hypoglycemia which is frequent or large glucose fluctuation independently contribute to diabetes related complications. And glycemic variability, increased glucose variability, is associated with mortality also in patients with ICU. So the glycemic variability, we can say it's a better predictor of hypoglycemia than A1C. So alone A1C will not able to know that whether patient was having any episodes of hypoglycemia or not. But if you can measure the glycemic variability, it's much better parameter to measure. The vascular complication along with glycemic variability, not a very big data which we have, but still a lot of publications are there which shows that there is a substantial role of glycemic variability in development of complication. And this publication was in 2019, which talked about that more the glycemic variability, there is an increasing cardiovascular events. More glycemic variability, the CV autonomic dysfunction was more the glycemic variability, more microvascular and macrovascular complication, and more the glycemic variability increase the risk of hypoglycemia also. Now, as we are talking about the hyperglycemic memory, it's a glycemic excursion trigger oxidative stress. This oxidative stress increase in that it causes defective angiogenesis, activate pro-inflammatory pathways, long-lasting epigenetic changes, and this will have a hyperglycemic memory. So somebody who is having uncontrolled diabetes will have a memory which is of bad glycemic memory. The continuous glucose monitoring is the best way to know the glycemic variability. So I mean, as I told you, we moved from sugar to A1C, now a new methodology to monitor this glycemic variability. It is the glucose monitoring which we can do, and now thanks to this newer technology which is available to our country also, is a continuous glucose monitoring which we can do for many of our patients. In this particular slide, I wanted to just show that there could be a three different type of patient with the same A1C. They may have similar A1C, but one patient may have a completely out of range, multiple time hypo and multiple time hyperglycemia, but still the patient is having almost A1C of 7 or 7.2 or less than 7.2. The other patients where you can have 70% of the time patient is in range, 25% is high, 5% he may be in lower side, and still the A1C of this person may be absolutely normal. And the third class of patient, third variety of the person who is having all the time 100% the sugar is remaining controlled, and still the sugar is well controlled and A1C is less than 7. So this recommendation, which is from the international consensus on use of CGM, just to inform that I was the part of this international consensus, and where we talked about that 70% of the time, and more than 70% of the time, one should have the sugar between 70 to 180. And that was, it was a consensus which was accepted by American Diabetic Association in their guideline also. It was an accepted paper in 2019, then in 20 and 21, it was in a recommendation. It had become that more than 70% of the time, somebody should be in the range. That is what time in range. And to explain our patient in a much better way, I explained them your glucose in range. That is, you know, how much time in 24 hours your glucose remain in the range of 70 to 180. This is the same paper which was published in 2021. It was a again the CGM guideline. They had explained in a very simple way. This is in a bar form, that more than 70% of the time one person should have the sugar between 70 to 180. But it is acceptable if it goes less than 5% of the time. Less than 5% of the time, below 70 also. But it is not acceptable if it goes more than 1% of the time, less than 54. Similar way, it is not acceptable if somebody's sugar goes more than 5% of the time, more than 250. That is not excellent. Expected also, and it is we have to change the therapy if somebody goes above the 250, or if it goes less than 100. Less than 54 by more than 1% of the time. So the importance of maintaining time in range, there are data which supports that if someone have a better time in range, there is a risk of microvascular complication, whether it's talk of retino, nephropathy or peripheral neuropathy, they are significantly decreased. And those who have uncontrolled diabetes, particularly time in range is not maintained, they have more risk of microvascular complication. So just to talk about the glycemic variability, I had just explained that what exactly we are meaning of by glycemic variability. Then my study which we have done with the teneligliptin, the teneligliptin study, the top TIR study which we have done, teneligliptin effect on glycemic control through parameters of time in range. So this is what my study name, which is top TIR study. The study title was, it's a prospective multicenter open label study to assess the effect of teneligliptin on glycemic control through parameters like time in range metric using continuous glucose monitoring. We had used ambulatory glucose profile Libre Pro for this particular study. The rationale of this study, as it is one of the most widely prescribed gliptin in our country, it is only administered in a 20 milligram OD dose. Few centers or few doctors would like to uptitrate it up to 40 milligram. There is a limited data of teneligliptin in a time in range parameter, particularly Indian type 2 diabetic patients. So you may have the data of teneligliptin is an efficacy, but we don't have the data that how much it improves the time in range. Hence, this study was planned to assess the effect of teneligliptin on glycemic variability using continuous glucose monitoring. The objective was very clear, to evaluate the percentage of time in range in patients who are treated with teneligliptin. Secondary objective was definitely how much it caused time below range, time above range, glycemic control and tolerability. And three different sites were there along with me, Dr. A.G. Unnikrishnan, Suha, and myself. We had done with the patients who are with teneligliptin 20 milligram OD without regards to meal, and metformin. These patients were actually, it is 1300 milligram plus minus 356. So some of the patients were on 1000 milligram, and some of the patients even up to 1700 milligram also. Any stable dose of was continued throughout the study. It was day 1, day 4, day 5 to 14 and day 33 to 46. These were the time frame for all primary and secondary endpoints which we have taken. Primary endpoint, as I talked to you about the change in the time in range. The secondary endpoints was all below range, above range, time, the mean A1C, mean glucose level, A1C, fasting plasma glucose, postprandial glucose level, incidence of adverse events, serious adverse events, all were taken as a part of this study endpoints. The inclusion criteria were male and female patients having type 2 diabetes, more than 18, less than 65, type 2 diabetic patients on metformin for more than 6 weeks, stable dose, HbA1c should be uncontrolled, more than 7.5, and type 2 diabetes who are gliptin naive. So this was the inclusion criteria, and not to talk about the exclusion part. Study flow was this: CGM was implanted on day 1, teneligliptin 20 milligram introduced from day 4. So why we wanted to do it on day 5? Because we wanted to know that first 4 days, when person is only on metformin, what exactly exactly happens. And on fifth day, we had put the patient on a tenliclipton. The CGM device was removed on 15 days. So, you know, the last 10 days data of that we have taken when the person was taking already the gliptin. Then someone can ask that the gliptin effect will not be from the day one. I mean, that's the reason we have done one more CGM after 2 months. The tenliclipton 20 milligram continue. A new CGM device was implanted on day 33, and then it was continued for another 14 days and it was removed on day 47. So the first 4 days or 5 days we have taken when person was not on tenliclipton, just to see that how much glycemic variability happens a person who is already on metformin only with sugar of 7.5 or above. This is the study which I talked about, day 1 to 4 pre-treatment, day 5 to 14 post-treatment. Patient was continued with the stable dose of the metformin and gliptin, and then again from 33 to 46 days, it was again done for a 14 days of continuous glucose monitoring. Efficacy assessment and safety assessment has been done just to see that how much fasting postprandial glucose A1C reduction was done, and at the same time, we had also taken care of all adverse event if at all it had happened during that 45 days. The results are very interesting because these are the patients who are done, 59 patients where patient characteristics, vital parameters and biochemical parameters was taken. Continued who had done for the 2 glucose monitoring was only 54, and 55 was in the first test. I mean, we could not do for one of the patient. The pre-protocol analysis protocol population was 54, and 42 patients of these were between the range of 7.5 to 10.5 at baseline. The glycemic parameters, you can see the fasting plasma glucose is reduced significantly from 211 to 161, with 241 baseline PPBS to 183, with A1C reduction of 9.35, that was an average, to 8.48, with a significant P value which you can see here. So I mean, that shows the efficacy of the gliptin, but our primary idea to see that how much it can have a better time in range. The BMI, the high sensitive CRP, the SGOT, SGPT, urea creatinine, all these parameters were taken from day 1 and day 47, but one significant difference was only with A1C, so there was no any other adverse events which was there. Now this is the CGM parameters which I wanted to talk to you. The average glucose with baseline was 156. In phase, it has become 144, 139. Now, percentage time in range, which is between 70 to 180. These patients who are uncontrolled diabetic patient with more than 7.5, they were having 64% of the time, they were in this time in range. And when after adding the tenliclipton, it had increased to 75% of the time. So, I mean, that was what the primary objective of the study, that these patients who are uncontrolled, more than 7.5 A1C, only on metformin, after putting the gliptin, how many of them we could have a better control, particularly in time in range. I am not bore you by showing other things. There was no possibility of getting any hypoglycemia, so no time below range was not there, and it was having significant P value by improving time in range with the patients who were put on a tenliclipton. The CGM parameters, as I already told you, this is showing a significant P value from 64, it has increased to 75.07 and 75.68. Where there was time below range, there was no significant difference, there was no patient who was going in hypoglycemia. The comparison of time in range between baseline, phase 1 and phase 2 for patient with baseline TIR less than 70, it was in a mean, there was a significant difference between a baseline phase 1 and phase 2 as far as time in range is concerned. Tenliclipton is well tolerated among all patients. There was no safety issue which was there in the clinical trial. There was no side effects which was reported also. So the top TIR external comparison, if I do with the this study, it is a small study with the 59 samples, but if I do with the canagliflozin in combination with tenliclipton, this is the patient who had shifted from tenliclipton to cana. This is a switch group where 48 patients were shifted, and a cana was added to tenliclipton, which is in a combo group, which is 51 patient. And then we have done also compared in the TEDDY study, which is tenliclipton with placebo. So I just wanted to tell you that time in range in tenliclipton, we have done completed 4 study at different centers. My study, which was I was the investigator for top TIR, but we have also one comparison study with a switch group where the patient was switched from tenliclipton to cana. So I mean, these were already on metformin and tenliclipton. Now tenliclipton was stopped and they were put on the metformin and cana. The other study was Cana was added to the Tenalegriptin. So that was the third group, which is a COM group, where Cana was added to the Tenalegriptin. And the TEDDY, which is the one more study where the Tenalegriptin was compared versus placebo. So here the placebo was added, metformin and Tenalegriptin. Other group was metformin with Tenalegriptin. And almost in all, sample size was 59, 48, 51 and 65. You can see the duration of all these study was roughly around 6 weeks, because we wanted to do two times continuous glucose monitoring. The Tenalegriptin versus placebo was for 12 weeks. And you can see the HbA1c inclusion criteria for almost all these patients were more than 7 or 7.5. They were uncontrolled diabetes. And A1c reduction with Tenalegriptin was a significant. It was in an average around 0.87 in our group, in our study, top TIR, and 0.84 in TEDDY group. Also, time in range is improved in the patients who were put on Tenalegriptin, even with the switch group also, and also in the combo group, where there was increase and improvement in time in range. And time in range was also in much better in compared to the patients who were in the placebo arm, in compared to those patients who were added with metformin and Tenalegriptin. To conclude my talk, Tenalegriptin treatment reduced the glycemic variability, which we had seen in this top TIR study. There was significant improvement in mean time in range at the end of a study as compared to baseline. There was significant improvement in mean time above range, and at the end of a study when it is compared with baseline. So, I mean, there is a time above range which was very, very high, those patients who have uncontrolled diabetes, which had significantly reduced. There was also significant improvement in mean HbA1c at the end of the study, which is only 42 days. I mean, you can see it was only for 1.5 months, still we have repeated the A1c, and there was reduction in that A1c. The last study which I had shown, the TEDDY, where we have done for 12 weeks, and there it was showing much better in compared to R40, but both the what was a significant p-value was reduced. Tenalegriptin led to early glycemic improvement that we had seen even from baseline to phase 1. So what we had seen even in those patients, because first 4 days there was no gliptin was given, it was only on metformin. Patients were put on continuous glucose monitoring. On 5th day we introduced the Tenalegriptin, and then from 5th day to 14 days we have done. And what we had seen, even by starting the therapy within 10 days, we had seen there was a significant improvement in time in range. Tenalegriptin was well tolerated. So we can say it's a promising drug to reduce the glycemic variability in patients with type 2 diabetes. We may have the data, and we have the data with other gliptins also. It is just one more add-on data for Tenalegriptin to show that it also improves time in range, and it is tolerable and with significant reduction in A1C. Once again, I thank industry, particularly Glenmark, for supporting this study and supporting this talk for RSSDI. Thank you. Thank you very much.